Mr. Taru, we're going to start talking about geometric sequences. I thought I'd, you know, try some other way to get in the camera for a change. A sequence in which each term after the first is obtained by multiplying the preceding by a fixed non-zero constant. Now, I just posted a couple of videos about working with arithmetic sequences. Now we're moving on to geometric. So, instead of constantly or repetitively adding, now we are repetitively multiplying. Okay, so, common ratio right here. Okay, we've got a sub n is equal to a sub 1 times r to the n minus 1 power. We had multiplication with the arithmetic sequences because multiplication indicates repeated addition. Exponents are for repeated multiplication. Common ratio, as you look at your list of numbers and you try to identify if it's arithmetic or geometric, go through those values, and this is very simple, we're just multiplying by 2, but you know, back divide, 2 divided by 1, 4 divided by 2, 8 divided by 4. Take any term in the sequence, divide it by the previous term, and don't do that just once. Do that a number of times to make sure that you're getting the same ratio over and over and over again, and it just doesn't start off looking like it's geometric, but really not. And don't forget with these sequences, your domain value, the values of n that you're allowed to plug into your a sub n expression are just your positive integers. Now, this is not the first time that we've taken an initial value and had a repetitive multiplication applied to it. We talked about in our past studies exponential growth and decay. If b is greater than 1, it's exponential growth. If b is less than 1, it's exponential decay, or between 0 and 1. We've also had a couple of questions about finance, whether it's compound interest compounded yearly or compounded continuously with the PERC formula. Of course, there's other compound formulas, annuity formulas, whatnot. But the difference between these formulas and this formula, again, the biggest difference is these are all continuous graphs so that the domain is all real numbers. Now, if these are money problems, application problems, you might be able to argue that maybe your domain is all real numbers greater than or equal to zero, but these will display a smooth curve, whereas if you remember about with sequences, with the domain being just positive integers, if you were to graph the values from a geometric sequence, you would just get a bunch of distinct individual points above your end values of 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. You would not want to connect those dots. Now, in this video, we're just going to do a few examples, actually four, where I give you some information and ask you for the general term of that geometric sequence, the a sub n expression, if you will, or equation. So, we have values of 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, and 32. Clearly, I'm just multiplying by 2, but if I'm multiplying by 2 repetitively, that's a geometric sequence. So, to write out my formula here, a sub n is equal to a sub 1, my first term in my sequence, times r, well, I'm constantly multiplying by 2, and then that is to the n minus 1 power. And let's not forget, why is it n minus 1 and not just n? Because we're starting off with the first term. We start off with n being 1. And to get to the second term, where n equals 2, we only have to multiply by the value of 2 once. To get to the third term, well, yes, I'm on the third term, but I started off with a sub 1. So to get to the third term, I only had to multiply twice by the value of 2. And then the fourth term, a sub n, I'll have to multiply by 2 three times. So I'm multiplying by n minus 1. Okay, so that's pretty much done. There's nothing else to do with that. This question here, the second example, is really almost as easy as well. Maybe it's even easier. At least with this, I had to figure out my own r value by doing, you know, a sub n divided by a sub n minus 1, a sub n divided by a sub n minus 1, and make sure I get the same ratio. So this one is just, boom, let's just write it out. A sub n is equal to negative 8 times my r value of negative 1/4 raised to the n minus 1 power. My next example here is a recursive set of formulas where I have an equation for a sub 1, and then a sub n is equal to negative 2 times a sub n minus 1. So in other words, to find any term in the sequence, go to the one just before it, and then multiply it by negative 2. So, you know, we might be able to, and I can write, of course, out the equation for a sub n like right now. If you can't, or if you're not really sure what it would be, you could write this list out. Okay, the first number is 7. That's a sub 1. To find a sub 2, I'm going to go to the previous number and multiply it by negative 2, which is negative 14. I have a video about recursive formulas, so I don't want to really break this down super detailed. To find a sub 3, I'm going to take a sub 2 and multiply it by negative 2. So negative 14 times by multiplied by negative 2 is positive 28, and then so on. So I am multiplying by negative 2, and I do have an a sub 1 value of 7. So a sub n is equal to a sub 1, which is 7, times negative 2 raised to the n minus 1 power. Let's get one more example out of the way, and maybe two more examples, and call this video a day. Move on to partial sums. Okay, two more examples, quite a bit more difficult. Here's a sequence of values, and I want, you know, I want to identify what type of sequence it is, whether it's arithmetic, geometric, or neither, and then come up with an expression if it's one of those two special types. Okay, why is it impossible for this list of values to be arithmetic? Well, the reason why is we go from positive to negative to positive to negative and then so on. So the only way your signs are going to be able to flip-flop back and forth like that is if you're multiplying by a negative value. So there's no way that this could be an arithmetic sequence. Now, how about being geometric? I can't just look at this and, like my previous example, go, oh, I'm just multiplying by 2. So what we're going to have to do is back divide a couple of these and make sure we get the same answers a couple of times. So we've got negative 16 over 27 divided by 8 ninths. Now, you know you can't really divide fractions. You multiply by the reciprocal of the second fraction. So I'm going to erase this and say, okay, instead of dividing by or writing dividing by 8 ninths, I'm going to multiply by 9 eighths. And the 8 and the, let me pick a different color here, the 8 and the 16 are going to cancel out to be negative 2. The 9 and the 27 are going to cancel out to be 1 third, and we have a ratio, an R value, that is equal to negative 2/3. Now that's not enough to prove to me that this is a geometric sequence, even though I know it is. So let me just check it one more time. You might want to do it two times just to make sure with your work. So let's take these two and divide them and make sure we get the R value of negative 2/3 again. So we're going to take 32, let's write it a little bit differently, 32 over 81 divided by negative 16 over 27. Anytime you have a fraction over a fraction, I wrote my initial example sideways, you're going to have to flip up that bottom fraction because that's the fraction you're dividing by, and you're going to want to multiply by the reciprocal. So we're going to multiply by 27 over 16. Whoops, a little bit sloppy there. So let's see, what will cancel out between 32 over 81 multiplied by negative 27 over 16? Well, again, 32 and 16, those are going to cancel out to be 2 over 1, and 27 and 81. What's 81 divided by 27? It's going to come out to be negative 3, and I'm just going to put the negative down here that is next to this 27. So 27 over 81 reduces to be 1 third, or R again is equal to negative 2/3. So I checked it a couple of times and I got R value and R value of negative 2/3, and if I recognize that I'm constantly multiplying by the same value, then I've identified this as a geometric sequence. So we have a sub n is equal to a sub 1 times my constant R value of negative 2/3 raised to the n minus 1 power. Next example. Here, I'm giving you the sixth term in the sequence, and I'm telling you that the r value is equal to 1 half. Well, if I'm going to write out my answer, my general term, my formula for the geometric sequence, I need to know what a sub 1 is, and I already know what r is. Okay, this is geometric, but I don't know what a sub 1 is. However, to get down the line, I'm multiplying by 1 half. So if I want to go in the opposite direction, get up the line and back to a sub 1, I could just, you know, do the opposite or the reciprocal of multiplying by a half and multiply by 2 to get, you know, to go backwards through the row of values and get to a sub 1 and just work out the pattern. But this might be a sub 16 or something where you wouldn't want to do that much work by hand. So we're going to set up the a sub n formula. Okay, a sub n is equal to a sub 1 times r to the n minus 1 power. A sub n, now we're going to work with a sub 6. So a sub 6 is equal to 1 eighth. I don't know what a sub 1 is, that's what I'm trying to figure out. My constant ratio is 1 half. And again, I'm given a sub 6, so my n value is equal to 6, and we have 1 eighth equals a sub 1, 1 half to the fifth power. 1 times 1 times 1 times 1 times 1 is 1, and 2 to the fifth power is 2, 4, 8, 16, and 32. So, we're going to multiply both sides by 32. 32 divided by 8 is equal to 4. Now I've got my first term, I've got r, and that means I've got my a sub n formula. Or I've got my answer. I'm Mr. True. That's your introduction to geometric sequences. Let's move on to partial sums. Bam! Go do your homework.